Okay, good morning, everybody. First of all, thanks to Julia and Nazari for organizing the session. It's nice to see once in a while people with very similar problems to myself. Anyway, I'll present my humble contribution to the discussion, which is concerned with the evaluation or testing of a QField program for archaeological survey. So with QField, actually, I noted that we are using QGIS. So basically, QField is QGIS for Android. Put it simply, the program itself is built with regard to compatibility with desktop to QGIS program. It's simplified to the extent so it's easily usable on the touch screen. And it's built around modes of using, meaning you can either browse the data in the field or digitize new data in the field, of course. So the two basic modes of functioning of this program. As for the format support, it does shapefiles, specialized PostGIS, the geospatial databases, and support for GeoPackage, which is both vector and raster format, also supporting multiple geometries in vector format. From other raster formats, it so far is support for TIF or GeoTIFF also, and actually also for web mapping services, VMS and MB tiles. So the format support is quite wide, and it's important that those are native GIS formats, meaning you don't have to export from, work with more formats native to GPS, to PDA devices. You directly work with the formats you use in GIS work in desktop. Anyway, the workflow starts with creating a portable project, which is a QGIS file with all the layers stored in a single folder, which is uploaded onto the mobile device. Everything regarding the project setup, the setup of coordination system, the layer setup, layer behavior, and everything is set on desktop QGIS. The creation of the portable project itself, you can do it manually, or there's an app or plugin for QGIS, you can see here on the picture, like synchronization plugin. As for the layers, there are basically two possibilities how to work with them. Either you are making a working copy for the portable project, meaning that you have two copies of single layer, one on desktop, one on the portable device. Or there is possibility of offline editing, meaning that the program stores a changelog, it keeps track of all changes, and then with help of this plugin, you can synchronize the original file on your computer from that changelog, which is much more easier or much more, less problematic because you still keep only one file, not multiple files for a single layer. It's also important when working with large raster files. In my example, it was almost 2 gigabytes. There's possibility to convert the rasters to the base map, which is stored in a GeoPackage format, which is much more compact and can be easily used on the mobile devices, which usually doesn't have large memory. Anyway, start with the case studies. The first one is concerned with the initial salvage survey of a site Khirbet, es-Swade, Maʾagar Snir in the northern Israel. The site of the survey covers some 52 hectares, located on the basalt plateau south of the Hermon Massif and some 2 kilometers south of the ancient city of Caesarea Paneas. Also located close to the source of the River Jordan. You can see the survey area itself. This was supplied, this orthophoto was kindly supplied by the development company. As I said, the survey was designed as initial survey survey, meaning our goal was to make an archaeological assessment of the site. From previous surveys, there was known site Khirbet es-Swade itself, from Roman to early medieval times, and also remains of a Roman road were noted in the previous surveys, but the area here was without any archaeological information. As you can note, it's not so well visible on the big screen, but from the orthophoto you can see linear features, probably terraces, some field walls between the terraces. Also we can note numerous oval stone features, probably cairns. So our goal, first of all, was to verify these features found on the orthophoto, survey the area in general, and then carefully survey the wooded area in the south western part. So the survey was designed as extensive, meaning we are concerned with the visible archaeological remains, with the visible structures. Therefore, we are not collecting pottery. The pottery was noted during the survey and observed, but it was not collected. As for the hardware, I'm using my personal tablet, which is I think like mid-range, nothing special really. And QField version 0.8. The survey was conducted last year in March. So that's why I'm adding the information about the version of the software, because it developed over time. Anyway, this is the screen of the program, how it looks like on the laptop. As I said, it's built on two modes, both in digitizing. You can see the list of layers. I was saying earlier, I was using as a base map the orthophoto from the development company, a polygon shape file for the extent of the survey area, 20 meter grid for better orientation in the terrain. It was also the first run, my first run of this program, so I wasn't sure how could I orient myself in the terrain with that. And a single point shape file for storing the survey information, which was designed in a rather minimalistic way. The first field is the ID field for custom numbering system. The most important type field, which is stores information on the type of the feature surveyed. Obligatory note field and photo field marking if the given feature was photographed or not, because during the survey we obviously collect awful amount of pictures, so that you can later sort it out according to this attribute table. This is the result, what it looks like after the 2 days of survey. In the end, some 520 points were collected in 2 days. These were sorted out according to the type field in the attribute table, so that the linear features could be drawn. Everything was sorted out, and this map accompanying the final report of the survey was produced. So basically what you can see here are the field terraces on the slope. The whole area is sloping from the from west to the east. Nice field walls with parcels, probably late medieval or early Ottoman, hard to say. Some 283 stone cairns were noted in the survey. From the smallest one is like half a meter in diameter, the largest are over 3 meters and 1.8 meters high. There is a tower identified, probably Roman or Byzantine. Maybe there is some connection with the track of the Roman road, and two farmhouses, or perhaps one large agricultural complex dating probably from the late medieval or early Ottoman times, or late Mamluk, early Ottoman times. and also other agricultural installations, lime kilns, and ovens. The other example is concerned with the survey of Hellenistic, Roman, and Byzantine fortifications in the territory of Antiochia Hippos in the southern Golan Heights. It's part of my ongoing PhD. The goal is not only to get the precise point of a given fortification or the given site, but also to draw to produce a plan of the site and take a landscape approach to the study of the fortifications, meaning that also the environment of the of each site was surveyed in order to assess if it's really a military site or is it a civilian site, and so on. So similar to the previous survey, it's extensive. We are not concerned with collecting pottery. We don't have a license for that, meaning that only the basic information of the sites are collected. The survey area you can see here is characterized by a basalt plateau of the Golan Heights, dissected by numerous deeply incised wadis and several perennial rivers in the south, Jaromuk and Rukat. And the whole region is centered on the city of Hippos, located some 2 kilometers east of the Sea of Galilee. The survey started in current form in last autumn, and most of it was done during this winter. So you can see that the program, the version 0.10, is slightly different. On the left, in the browse mode, you see the list of layers. Here I am working rather than with DEM than with the contour map, again for better orientation in the terrain. The main survey files are the point shape file storing information on the sites, and the walls shape file for drawing plans of the sites in the field. This is just an example of the browsing of the data. This was by simple tapping on the screen. The window opens on the right, so you can see all the basic information of the sites collected during the survey and of the supporting layers. This is taken, the settlement layer taken from the Archaeological Survey of Israel database. And you can, when you open it, you can see basically the attribute table of each given feature for help with the conducting the survey actually in itself. As for the survey file, again it was designed in a very minimalistic way, storing mainly the type of the site in a field, obligatory notes field and a photo field. This time not noting if the feature was or was not photographed, but the program supports camera integration. It means it's possible to take a picture with a tablet or with a phone, and the picture is stored in the attribute table together with the other information for a given feature. Another important thing which is very handy is if you do your homework and prepare correctly the layers on desktop, you can make these nice drop-down lists. So basically adding a new feature on the map is a matter of like 2 seconds, basically, if you don't need to write some short note for the given feature. Also, since you can do the setup on desktop, you can work with local coordinate system immediately. And for the walls, for the drawing of the walls, also we can immediately see the length of the walls. So it could be also used as a simple measuring device in the field. These are the results. It doesn't look nice. We'll explain why. The red lines are walls drawn with QField. The black lines are walls drawn from orthophoto derived from a drone footage. So here we see the problem of accuracy, especially if we combine outputs from two GPS devices, from the tablet and from the drone. Here the difference is some 2 to 3 meters between each input. However, to say this is the most extreme case. In most cases, my precision is around 1.5 meter. I had the opportunity to check it in the former project against the orthophoto and the features digitized there. So, to conclude, what I like about the QField is it's an open platform, meaning it's not just a free and open source program, but really you can tailor your own portable project to your own needs, to your own research design, however you want. If you know how to work with QGIS, and I assume that some of you are using it already, so it's nothing complicated. It's very simplified, it's very user-friendly, straightforward. It's also important that it's uniform data collection. Once you set up the project, you can use it all through the survey project with all the problems. And as I said, what is important is really the data are stored immediately in the GIS native format. There is no issues of turning the data from one format native to GPS or PDA to different format on desktop computer. It's, I think, the main issue here also. The program itself is very stable. The stability greatly improved over the past year. So basically no way of losing data unless really the hardware crashes. Which brings us to the issues of hardware. It was noted also in previous discussions and previous contributions. Simply GPS is not total station. But we are usually interested in the larger structures, then half a meter resolution doesn't make much of a difference. Another issue would be how to solve the coordination or cooperation of multiple users on multiple devices on a single project. I think this could be done through the changelog, but so far I didn't have opportunity to check it. Anyway, if you're interested, you can check the webpage of the developers, or you can download it from the Google Play Store. Well, that's for me. Thank you.